This is a saobing youtiao, which is essentially fried bread in bread. A bread sandwich, if you will. It's a common breakfast item in northern China and shows just how much people here love their wheat. Other dishes in this region include black bean noodles, jianbing, and fluffy pork buns. Today, we're heading to northeastern China and focusing on the food of Beijing, Tianjin, and Shandong. The region's cuisine is known in Chinese as lu cai, and it's the food of old Chinese royalty. Chinese food is more than just stir-fry noodles and dumplings. I'm Clarissa, and I'm taking you on a journey through China to try authentic Chinese food region by region. Lu cai, or lu cuisine, is the last of our four main regions of Chinese cuisine. Technically speaking, lu cai refers to the food of Shandong province. It's a cooking style that eventually spread to the neighboring cities of Beijing and Tianjin. Wheat is a dominant carb in this part of China because it doesn't get all that much rain. A popular breakfast item here is youtiao, a deep-fried wheat cruller that can actually now be found everywhere in China. Another big breakfast item here is the jianbing, a crepe made with mung bean flour. Buns and noodles are other staples here. The buns are usually leavened with yeast so that they're fluffy and soft. For the noodles, there's zha jiang mian, noodles topped with sweet and salty black bean sauce, ground meat, sliced cucumbers, and bean sprouts. Then there's fresh handmade noodles, which can be served in beef or lamb noodle soup. This region is close to Inner Mongolia, so there's a huge supply of beef and sheep. That's why you'll find a lot of meat in northern Chinese cuisine. But the emblematic meat dish of this region is Beijing roast duck, sometimes called Peking duck. But did you know it actually came from the south? Here's the story. Roast duck was a popular dish in Hanzhou, which is the capital of China over 800 years ago. Hanzhou in the south is surrounded by lakes and rivers, making it a natural breeding ground for ducks. When the country's capital moved north to Beijing during the 13th century, roast duck went with it and quickly became a favorite among royals. It's remained a palace staple ever since. Northern Chinese food is also known for its love for wild game. During the Qing Dynasty, it became popular because the Manchu rulers loved hunting. They would hunt for deer, mutton, rabbit, and pheasants. Deer in particular was so prized that herds of them were rounded up from across the country and brought within the perimeters of the emperor's hunting grounds south of Beijing. Imperial cuisine sourced ingredients from all over the country, such as lychee from Guangxi and tofu noodles and ham from Jiangsu. The region's proximity to the ocean also means lots of seafood. You'll find braised sea cucumber and deep-fried yellow croaker on the dinner table. There's also Spanish mackerel, which is minced and wrapped into dumplings. Proximity to the sea also means lots of salt, and this region's cuisine is probably the saltiest in the country. Dishes tend to be seasoned with lots of salt, garlic, and green onions. As for dessert, there's a deep love for maltose, a sugar derived from grains, which the north has plenty of. The sugar is used to caramelize things like sweet potatoes and apples. Lu cuisine is comfort food at its finest. Greasy, salty, and very hearty. Up next, we'll go on a food tour of Beijing and meet a man who's been making Beijing-style roast duck for over 2 decades. And then go to Tianjin to learn how to make pork buns. Stay tuned. Welcome to Beijing, the capital of China. Once a walled city, today it is a modern metropolis housing the country's seat of power. But closer to the ground, you'll find street food galore. Snack carts were once a common sight on the streets of Beijing, but many of them have since moved indoors into food courts and restaurants. So, if you just had one day in Beijing, what would you eat? The traditional dishes are heavy on carbs, meat, and offal. I hit up my friend Carla, who took me around to some of her favorite places.
其实北京的美食从我小时候到现在，我觉得老北京的吃食都没有变过。北京这边很融合，对于主食的选择，炸酱面也吃。 然后牛肉面也吃，馒头呀、大饼都吃，吃起来饱腹感特别强，特别过瘾的感觉。
Today we're in Beijing with my friend Carla.
我叫张扬，大家可以叫我卡拉。那2005年到现在，在北京算是第15年头了。那现在我们就来到了北京的一个著名的喝豆汁儿的地方。这些吃的东西也都是很多土生土长的北京人带我去吃的。这家店的豆汁儿是尤其的好喝。也许一会儿你们尝一下，有可能你们喝不惯，因为那个味道真的很特别，它是发酵的口感。豆汁呢是原材料是绿豆，我会觉得这个小店看起来也许不是装修最好的，也许不是说看起来最干净最整洁的，但确实是味道做的最好的。北京菜有其实是有宫廷菜这个派系的，然后还有一个是大众吃的。宫廷菜它会做的像糕点啊，还有像北京传统小吃驴打滚，比如说像豌豆黄，吃到的口里特别润。这家呢主要是做炒肝，但其实其他的像北京特色小吃这家也有。美国的副总统来中国访问的时候就要来这边吃了一下，所以当时姚记就瞬间火了一下。当时来这儿基本上就是没有位子，特别满。炒肝也是老北京的特色，然后你尝一口，它里面会带一点点蒜香。北京人传统一说吃炒肝，要一碗炒肝必然要配一个包子，杏仁豆腐这也有，而且上面做的很好看，有一点点桂花，这个桂花的味道在老北京的传统小吃里用的比较多。那个酸奶的口味就特别好，像今天我们喝的这种也是自制的，自制的这种酸奶一般都是味道比较正比较醇厚。现在这个店呢就是在我们北京后海的边上的，叫爆肚张。北京的爆肚也是特别有名的一道小吃，北京的这个麻酱小料绝对在我看来是全国最好吃的麻酱小料。老北京还有一个特色小吃是炸酱面，他们是拿一半的黄酱，就是黄豆的黄豆酱和一半的甜面酱去炒。其实在北京大家喝着啤酒吃着烤串就是夏天的一道风景线。我觉得北京其实真的不算一个美食天堂，但是在北京这里它是极大的物质上的丰富，给老北京的吃食，我这十几年其实都没有变过，但是还是那些老字号的会做的特别地道。
When it comes to Beijing food, few things are as iconic as roast duck. It is arguably the city's most famous dish and was once served in the Imperial Palace. So we went to an iconic restaurant that has been making the dish for nearly 3 decades.
这些它不是不像那个北京炸酱面，大烙饼、馅饼，这都针对下层居民。所以说它这里边有很深的文化底蕴。我是北京利群烤鸭店的前经理，到1991年的时候呢我临时下岗，这个时候呢我就在待业的时候自己开了这家利群烤鸭店，一直到今天， 20多年了，好的烤鸭，它现在就是分两种，一个是以便宜坊为代表的焖炉烤鸭，还有就是挂炉烤鸭。 像我们做的这种，这都是从御膳房传出来的技术。挂炉烤鸭就是烧果木用明火，就是在我们北京地区，那个主要就是枣木、杏木、梨木、桃木。用果木烤鸭呢，它有一个特殊的功效，就是果木燃烧起来，它的气味芬芳。 没有什么烟，所以说就是，对烤鸭的质量呢也好。比如说我们吃烤鸭配的饼，这都是上等面粉才能烙成那样，都铺到报纸上，能看到底下的字，然后在上面刷上烤鸭面酱，是吧？ 然后再加上鸭肉、葱丝儿一卷，而且你揉搓起来以后打开，它不破。烤鸭，我们这挂炉烤鸭这个技艺啊，比较劳动强度比较大。嗯，你想，一只鸭子4斤多沉。 加上鸭钩，反正很重，其实你就要用你手腕的力量，哎，把它挑进去，挑出来。这门技艺，就是在中国的这些个年轻人啊，现在都不爱做一些个，出力的事儿啊，都爱做一些个简单的、快乐的事儿，不像我们烤鸭那么又热，又累，是吧？
还有成天油啊水啊这些。Up next, we're heading to Tianjin to learn how to make a special kind of ball. Stay tuned. Balls are an iconic part of Chinese cuisine. They're a prolific symbol of Chinese culture in restaurants across the world. Of course, balls are everywhere in China, but they're especially loved in the north of China. And there's one city in particular that's known for them. We went there to learn. Today, we're in Tianjin with a guy whose family has been making baos here for over 200 years.
你像我这掐包子，不是说哎，我想掐包子，我一会儿就学会，不行，最少七天。 我叫何俊强，我是这个同义同宝第五代传人。我们店叫同义城，同义城呢怎么个来历呢？它是始于1776年。同义城
is one of three legacy bao brands in the city, and they all specialize in pocket-sized fluffy baos.
天津人俗称传统包就是传统主肉包。
Here's how he makes them. First, mix water and flour together.
一般的面粉呢，500克面粉用280克水。I see。正好适合这个包子面。OK。用筷子把这面搅拌，一点点搅拌均匀。
然后这水是冷水还是？冷水。根据季节，你到了冬季的是。
He adds a mixture is kneaded until the bowl is clean. It's then fed through this machine, which laminates the dough. This helps develop the gluten in the dough. The more developed the gluten is, the more chewy and full the final product will be. It's then laminated until it's smooth and wrapped in plastic to rest. Next, it's on to the filling. Ground pork is mixed with minced ginger, along with soy sauce, yellow cooking wine, sesame oil, canola oil, and scallions infused with sesame oil. Water is added in as necessary.
这个馅儿打完之后啊，用的水分比较大，嗯，不好包，容易出汤，怎么办呢？和完馅儿，提前和馅儿搁冰箱，冷冻一会儿。
OK， 就可以了。
哎，它就粘稠了。
I see。
我个人见解，不能作为什么用现代化调料，什么鸡精啊，完全依靠鸡精、味精去调整这些馅儿心，还是原生哇，什么东西都原生态比较好。
While the mixture is in the fridge, it's time to laminate the dough one last time. But how do you know a dough is done?
它这个我们用面，像我们熟悉了。一敲，敲什么？这面，幸好没幸好，敲听韵儿。
我可以敲小声。
可以。
OK。
跟声音一样，听声音。还有一种什么？切，拿刀切开，看两面的蜂窝状。哈。三种方法是闻，就闻到这个麦香味儿了。你听。
哦呀，真的很不一样。
不一样吧？刚才是跟生西瓜，这次跟熟西瓜一样。
Very,
你得闻的味道。
可以闻到
面香味，面香味也出来了。
Next, it's time to wrap the ball, which to me at least was the hardest part of the whole process. The dough is cut and rolled out with two rolling sticks, which ensures that the skin has a uniform thickness.
它不像饺子皮儿，饺子皮儿中间厚
，I see，
四周薄，
所以要
它这两个
均匀
平均的均匀。
均
这个面面杆就面部啊，一定别太多了。
我是22克的面皮，18克的馅儿心，
嫩一下，嫩的面粘在这大拇指上，就带着走了。
Finally, the bao is wrapped and then it's steamed for 4.5 minutes. So, what sets Tianjin baos apart from other baos?
你看这个，我们这个面呢是吧，皮儿薄，馅儿大，里头能兜住水，咬的时候有股子脆劲儿的面。说各家有各家的特色，南方的大包子一般就是24形法，面皮很厚，微微有点甜。北方包子就没有甜味儿，我认为很简单。
Did you know that chefs in northern China make some of the best noodles in the country? Just west of Beijing is the province of Shanxi, where they make noodles by shaving dough directly into boiling water.
削这个刀削面是有标准的，每2分钟180刀。我叫智树琴，从事刀削面工作，从学习到现在已经32年了。首先它也是有历史的。首先老以前人们都是以铁皮了什么了为了省事儿，后面经过年代长了，经过师傅们的精心改造，用这个锡钢片做出来的刀，首先这锡钢片做出来的刀快力，做刀削面的第一步是和面，面的比例是1斤面粉4两水。这刀削面的口感主要区别在于面粉，一般面粉选用碱性小一点的，韧劲大一点的，韧劲就是有劲儿，面劲儿，面筋，削出来的面口感好，有韧性啊，一定要把面柔光，必须达到盆光、面光、手光。柔光以后，烧醒5-6分钟、10分钟，这就可以开始削面下锅。一般刀削面的工具分为平刀和钩刀，大致2种。 一般这个刀削面的工具都是我们自己制作，现在我用的是大同的勾刀面，它是用锡钢片做出来的，因为锡钢片它锋利，磨出来以后相当锋利，没有毛边，柳叶形。这个削刀削面呀，必须得上下削平。一般刀削面削刀削面都在7寸到8寸，在学习的过程中，师傅们精心教导，手把手的教你，完了就是基本功了，和面了，完了就自己苦练。我就苦练，觉得最难的就是掌握那个角度，刀削面和面的角度，因为刀削面必须得刀不离面，面不离刀。
And that's it for our Eat China series. It's been such a ride. We learned how to make Cantonese rice noodle rolls in Hong Kong, sampled the bold and spicy flavors of Sichuan and Chongqing, went east to indulge our sweet tooth, and finished off in the north with lots of buns. Thank you so much for coming along with us on the journey.